It's often been said that youth, this period of time, is the time when man is at the peak of his abilities and motivations, right? During youth, or this period of time, we are at our strongest, our fastest, our sharpest. In other words, we are at the peak of our abilities and motivations. That's why this period of time that we call youth is regarded as man's best years. And actually, if we look at, you know, the lives of many people, we will realize that, hey, indeed, this is true. Because during this time, we see people making their greatest achievements in their lives during this time. For example, we've all heard of Alexander the Great, right? Alexander the Great first led troops at age 18 years old. How many of you here are 18 years old? Raise your hands. 18 years old? Any 18 years old here? Guess what? Alexander the Great first led troops or soldiers at age 18. You know what? He conquered almost the entire civilized world when he was only in his 20s. You say, boy, really? Yes. Alexander the Great, whom we admire for his exploits in war, actually was not an old man when he did all those things. He was only 18, and in fact, he conquered almost the entire world, in the civilized world, when he was only in his 20s, and he died at a young age of 33. Another guy, Raphael, the Italian painter, celebrated for the perfection of his paintings and drawings. You know what? He did his excellent works as a young man, and he died at the age of 37. Isaac Newton, he was only 24 when he formulated the law of gravity that we still study, we still believe in, okay? He formulated that law when he was only 24, and Isaac Newton made some of his greatest discoveries before 25 years old. Our national hero, Jose Rizal, he wrote the books Noli Me Tangere and El Filibusterismo, you know, when he was only in his 20s. Very young. We know how the books had influenced the people or the Filipinos during that time, right? They fueled nationalism because of that. You know, eventually they toppled the Spanish government. And of course, we know that Jose Rizal died very young. He was only 35 years old. But before that time, he was already able to accomplish many great things. And of course, my favorite, Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee performed great martial arts feats and invented his own martial arts when he was only in his 20s. Imagine. And he broke off his records, box office records, as an actor and director when he was in his early 30s. He died at the age of 32. I can go on and on and on, you know, of examples of people, of young people who have accomplished so many things at the prime of their lives. Now, you might have noticed that all the examples I gave you died young, right? So really don't know what they would have achieved well, if they lived longer. But at any rate, let me assure you that if these people were able to live longer lives, I tell you, their abilities and motivations will naturally weaken as they grow older, just like the rest of us human beings. But in the end, we see that it is actually during this period of time that we call youth that we are able to accomplish many great things. We are at the peak of our abilities and motivations. We are at our sharpest here, strongest here, and fastest here during this period of time. So we see that actually the Lord has given each one of us to have this period in life. The question is, how should we spend our youth years? How should we live our lives during our youth? Look at me in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 1 to 7. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 1 to 7. Listen to the words of Solomon, the wisest man the whole world during his time. He says, "Remember also your Creator in the days of your youth, before the evil days come and the years draw near, of which you will say, 'I have no pleasure in them.'" Basically, here he is telling us that we should remember our Creator, our God, in the days of our youth. And then in verse 2 and the following, he starts to use metaphorical language or figurative language to describe the process of aging and death. Okay, look at verse 12. Verse 1, he says, remember also your Creator in the days of your youth. Verse 2, he says, before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are darkened and the clouds return after the rain, in the day when the keepers of the house tremble. I believe he's talking about, you know, his arms and hands. You know, the house represents his body, and the keepers of the house are his hands and arms. It says here, in the day when the keepers of the house tremble, when you start to age, you know, your hands, your arms start to tremble, right? And the strong men are bent, and the grinders or the teeth cease because they are few, and those who look through the windows are dim. This is referring to the eyes. You know, as people age, their eyesight becomes poorer and poorer. And he uses that analogy here. Look through the windows that are dimmed. Verse 4, and the doors on the street are shut. Some Bible commentators say this referring to their mouth. When they eat less and less, or they talk less and less, and the doors on the street are shut. When the sound of the grinding is low, and one rises up at the sound of a bird. You know, people who are already advanced in age are light sleepers, right? You know, it's Solomon says, one rises up at the sound of a bird, describing the aging process, an old person. And all the daughters of song are brought low. He's talking about our voice, our ears. They are becoming less and less sharp. The daughters of song are brought low. They are afraid also of what is high or of heights. Isn't this true of the elderly? They are afraid of heights. And terrors are in the way. The almond tree blossoms. This is referring to gray hair, white hair. The grasshopper drags itself along, and desire fails. Because man is going to his eternal home, and the mourners go about the streets. And before the silver cord is snapped, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher is shattered at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern, and the dust returns to the earth as it was, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. What do we see here? In this passage, we see King Solomon telling us that we should remember our Creator in the days of our youth before we get old, and eventually before we die. Right? That's what he is trying to tell us here. He says in verse 1, remember your Creator. Everybody say, remember your Creator. Now, what does it mean to remember? To remember something basically means to bring something to mind, right? To bring something to mind. That's what it means to remember. It also means to think of something again, or to recall that thing, or to keep something in mind. That's what the basic meaning of remembering is. However, in this context, we will see that actually Solomon is not merely asking us to remember intellectually or mentally God. He's asking us to do more than that. Actually, in this context, Solomon is asking us, or exhorting us, to remember God in a sense of knowing Him, to remember God in a sense of worshiping Him, to remember God in the sense of obeying and serving Him, which is actually the essence of our existence. The foundational, the fundamental purpose of our existence. Why do we exist? Simple. To know God, to worship God, to obey God, to serve God. And that's it. And when Solomon said, remember your Creator in the days of your youth, he's actually saying that we should know God, we should worship God, we should obey God, we should serve God while we are still young. Okay? That is the essential purpose of our existence. Look at me, Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13 and 14. Who among you here have already read the book of Ecclesiastes? Raise your hands. Okay, some of you, good. What have you noticed about the book of Ecclesiastes? Is this a positive book or a pessimistic book? Who says positive book? Who says a very pessimistic book? It is actually a very pessimistic book, right? Right at the start, chapter 1, verse 1, Solomon says, meaningless, meaningless, everything is meaningless. You know, how's that to start a book? And I tell you, he did not mention that idea only on the first verse. He keeps on saying the same words and over again, like a refrain. No, he would talk about certain things, and then he would say, meaningless, meaningless, everything is meaningless. And he would move forward and talk about another thing, and then he would say, meaningless, meaningless, until the end of that book. He just keeps on saying, meaningless, meaningless, meaningless. And you might ask me, Pastor, why? Simple. Because Solomon, after evaluating all the aspects of life, he realized that apart from God, actually, everything is meaningless. You see, in this book, he evaluated money. You know, of course, people love money, right? He evaluated money. And he says, oh, you can work, you can earn, you can have all money. And yet, in the end, it's meaningless. Solomon also evaluated achievements. He said, oh, you can build buildings and so on and so forth. But in the end, it is meaningless. He also evaluated the pleasures of life. And he says, oh, you can enjoy all these things with all gusto. But in the end, these are meaningless. And he examined other aspects. In the end, he says, meaningless, meaningless, everything is meaningless apart from God. Now you might say, oh, Pastor Rich, maybe Solomon was kind of deprived in life. And it was just sour grapes. Get this, not in a million years. You know why? Solomon was no ordinary guy. If you know his life, it will blow your mind. I tell you, Solomon was not only rich. He was the richest man in the entire world during his time. He was not only powerful. He was the king of the most powerful kingdom on earth during the time. He was not only famous. He was the most famous person in the whole world. And if you want to talk about, you know, pleasures, worldly pleasures, get this. Solomon had 700 wives, queens and princesses, and 300 concubines. So talk about, you know, having and experiencing all the pleasures that this world is dreaming of. He had it all. Solomon had it. No one can rival him, even the richest people nowadays. No one can rival him. But towards the end of his life, after examining, experiencing, not just in theory, examining in theory, no, even experiencing all these things, he said, meaningless, meaningless, everything is meaningless apart from God. So, after saying meaningless, meaningless, everything is meaningless, he makes this conclusion at the end of the book. Look at me. In Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13 and 14. He says, verse 13, the end of the matter. In other translations, it says, here is the conclusion of the matter. All has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil. Okay? He says, in the end, we must go back to the whole duty of man, which is to fear God or to worship God and keep his commandments. Because it is for this reason that we exist. Okay? Now, we may also say that to remember God is to live for him, or to make him the center of our lives. Let me ask you this question. For whom are you living? Have you ever thought about that question? Have you ever asked that question of yourself? For whom are you living? Who is at the center of your life? Of course, we all know the standard answer to that, right? What's the standard answer? God is the center of my life. In Filipino, they say, "Weh." That's the standard answer. But the question is that true? If it's true, it should be shown in our actions, in the way we live our lives. Solomon says, remember your Creator in the days of your youth. And why should we remember God? We should remember God because our tendency as sinful human beings is to naturally forget Him. Including me, by the way. Including me. Our natural inclination is to forget God. For example, they say many people of this world go to church only thrice in their entire life. One, during their baptism when they were still infants. Two, during their wedding. Three, at their funeral. Three times only in their entire life. Other people are better than that. They come to church a few times a year, or specifically twice. They go to church during the Holy Week and Christmas. Right? Now, I've noticed a trend here. In recent years, I noticed that, you know, people are not really in the church during Christmas or Holy Week. It used to be that if you want to see more people in church, catch them during Christmas, right? Or Holy Week, they're there. But nowadays, in these recent years, I noticed that there is a different trend. Okay? People go out of town, people, you know, travel during Holy Week and Christmas. Just like this December, many people are out of town. Of course, we understand we have to have family time, right? But my only request is that wherever we are, we make it a point that we go to church, right? Just because we are on a holiday, we don't go to church. When it's Sunday, we still go to church wherever we are. And I'm very happy that we have some friends here who have visited us. Okay, some of you come from different towns and you make it a point to come here to church. Yeah, that's commitment to the Lord. Okay? Why is Solomon telling us to remember God? Because our tendency is to forget Him. Even Christians are also guilty of that. Right? For example, when we attend a retreat or a camp, we make all sorts of promises. But only after a few days or weeks, we forget them. We have to remember God. Now, it's very interesting that here in the passage, Solomon used the word Creator. Did you notice that? He didn't say, remember your God in the days of your youth. He specifically uses the word Creator. Of course, when Bible writers use words, they are very intentional about that. They have a reason why they chose a certain word. Now here, King Solomon uses the word Creator. Now what does it mean that God is our Creator? To say that God is our Creator implies that we are owned by Him. Did you catch that? We are owned by Him. He is our Creator. We are not owned by someone else. Okay? He was the one who has given us life. Therefore, He has all the rights over us. He owns us. To say that God is our Creator also implies that there is a purpose for our existence. We are not just random things here. Although atheists, scientists would want us to believe that. But the truth is, there's a reason why we are here. We have a Creator. And since we have a Creator, He had designed them in such a way that we have a purpose. Okay? We have a purpose for our existence, and that has been set by God Himself, our Creator. To say that God is our Creator also implies that we are ultimately accountable to Him, not to someone else. Meaning, whatever we do with our lives, we are going to answer for it before God at the right time. You cannot say, oh, I just want to live my life in any way I like. Just express yourself. You know, one of the things that people like to promote nowadays is magpakatotoo ka in Filipino. Magpakatotoo ka. Meaning, be true to yourself. And by that, they mean, you know, whatever you feel. Even if it hurts other people, whatever you want to do, if even it's indecent, just express it. Magpakatotoo ka. Be true to who you really are. Now, since when that thing has become a virtue? Have you ever thought about these things? Look at who among you are watching. One of the values, if you can call it value, I don't call it value, but one of the things that they value there is that the person, the contestants, will be true to themselves. Magpakatotoo. Meaning, if they're angry, they will lash out the people around them. You know, if they are maldita or naughty, they're free. They should. Actually, the producers want them to show who they really are. Regardless of the consequences of their actions or what they say, just show it. And they would praise you for that. Wow, you're so true, you're so genuine. Since when is indiscriminate expression, you know, has become a virtue? When you hold back, listen to this. We should not just go with the flow of this world. We know our values. We stand on our values. We are not perfect. We are not able to live perfect lives, but we must live accordingly by the grace of God, right? We have to be responsible. If what we are about to say or what we are about to do will affect other people in a negative way, you know, we hold back. And that's not hypocrisy. You know how this world has, you know, redefined things? They say, if you are so angry and you hold back, you don't tell the other person that you are angry, they say you are a hypocrite. Since when that is hypocrisy? That's being discreet. Right? You see, to say that God is our creator implies, among other things, that we are ultimately accountable for our deeds and words to Him. We cannot live our lives just about in any way we like to live it. Okay? Now, unfortunately, many people live their lives as if they are owned by other things, things other than God. For example, they live their lives as if they are owned by their careers. How do I know? Because they spend all of their time in their careers. They have no time for their families, no time for serving God. It's all about careers and about pursuing money. Now, you can say that God is at the center of your life all you want. You can say that you are living for God all you want. But in the end, if you spend most of your time in your career pursuing money, pursuing success, while neglecting your responsibilities to God and to your family, I tell you, you are not really living for God. God is not really owning you based on your kind of life. Okay? Other people are owned by their spouse, perhaps. Or for those who are still in the dating stage, they are owned by their girlfriend or boyfriend. The boyfriend says, oh, let's not go to church because, okay, let's not go to church. Oh, boy. So who is God here? God or the boyfriend or the girlfriend? Solomon says, remember your creator, the one who owns you, the one who has given you purpose, the one to whom you are accountable for the way you live your life. Now, let's move on. Solomon says, actually, to quote the entire thing, he says, remember your creator in the days of your youth. He specifies that. Remember your creator in the days of your youth. Again, we are in our prime during our youth years. We are at our strongest, fastest, sharpest during this time. And it's only but right that we devote our best years to God. Question, are we devoting our best years to God? Or are we devoting it to someone else? You see, only God deserves the best from you. We cannot just give God some loose change from our lives. Again, you can say, oh, God is at the center of my life. I'm living for God. If you're not really living that out, that's empty talk. God owns us. We give Him the best that we have, our best years. So we deliberately, we intentionally make a choice to live for Him. Let me give you several examples. King David, he was a mere youth when he killed Goliath and led Israel in numerous successful military campaigns. He was still very young, but he had a one-track mind for the glory of God. Just imagine. You know, many of the youth here are still playing DS or playing PS. While we are playing DS and PS, or maybe going out there, hopping from one party to another, guess what? King David, he was still young, he was fighting Goliath. And telling the giants, you know what? I'm going to give your carcass to God. In the name of the God of Israel, I'm going to cut off your head. Very good example to follow, right? King David. Another example of a youth who really served the Lord. Francis of Assisi. He was only 25 years old when he founded the Franciscan Order. And he was actually a son of a wealthy merchant. But he forgot about all these things. These material resources, he rejected them. Instead, he decided to give up his life of wealth for a simple life in order to serve God. He was only 25 when he founded the Franciscan Order. Meaning, before that, he was already very devoted to the Lord. John Calvin, one of the greatest reformers, he joined the Reformation at the age of 21. And at the age of 27, he wrote the book entitled The Institutes of the Christian Religion, a very influential Christian book or book on theology, which has profoundly influenced Christian theology and students of theology until now. The Institutes of the Christian Religion. In fact, many people nowadays, Christians, call themselves Calvinists because they have been influenced by this guy. He wrote this book when he was only 27. Jim Elliot, who among you have heard of Jim Elliot? Jim Elliot was a very promising guy. Okay, he graduated at the top of his class. He was invited by a big church in the U.S. to pastor the church. But you know what? He had a different calling from God. He said, I'm going to the Auca Indians. When his friends, peers in church, heard that, they said, what? You're going to give up this big church? For the Auca Indians, are you? The Auca Indians are savages. They kill people. They eat their flesh. But you see, Jim Elliot, you know, was so focused on bringing the gospel to them, so much so that he did not accept the big church. He went to the Auca Indians. You know what happened? At the age of 28, he was martyred. He was killed by the Indians. But you know what? By the grace of God, his death and the death of his fellow missionaries eventually led to the conversion of this savage tribe. Right now, if you go there in Ecuador, among the people of the Auca, you would see many churches. In fact, one of those people who killed his father and his companion missionaries became a pastor himself. And I saw him when I attended a conference in the U.S. in the church of John MacArthur. He's now a pastor, very old man. And the son of one of the missionaries during the time was killed together with Jim Elliot, who's now a grown-up guy, calls this Indian, Auca Indian pastor is now old as grandpa. The son of one of the missionaries that was martyred on the day together with Jim Elliot. You know, at the time he had a son, still a baby. His name is Nate Saint. Now he ministers with that old man who killed his father. He calls him grandpa. All these things happened because these guys dared to dream big dreams for God. Gave their little lives, their young lives, into the hands of God. Okay. How about us? Do we remember our Creator in the days of our youth? It's very sad because many young people are actually squandering this time of their lives. They are just wasting the time when they are at the peak of their abilities and motivations. Many young people are actually preoccupied with pursuing worldly ambitions and enjoying worldly pleasures. That's very sad. Yeah, just imagine if you are God. Just imagine for a moment that you are God. And you look at all these people that whom you have created, and you see most of them actually not living for you. Wasting their lives. Pursuing worldly things. What would you feel? That's what God is seeing. Every day. It's very sad, right? Yes, we are at the peak of our abilities and motivations during the time of youth, but if we do not devote ourselves to God, we will just be wasting it. Okay? In fact, many young people commit grave or the most serious blunders that they ever made in life during this time. Look at the lives of many young people. A good number of them have committed crimes during this time. Indulge in vices, indulge in, you know, activities that have ruined their lives of other people around them, even their families. And these all happen during their supposedly peak years, the youth. Now, unfortunately, even for many Christians, after receiving Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, you know, they just coast or cruise in their lives, doing whatever they like to do while waiting for the time they'll go to heaven. Because they think, you know, being saved, receiving eternal life from God means that, you know, when you die, you will go to heaven. And since I'm still alive, heaven is still far off, I just cruise, I just coast in life, and I'll do whatever I like. Waiting for the time when I get to heaven or Jesus Christ comes again. Listen up. If you think that having eternal life is just, you know, going to heaven, I tell you, you have a very narrow understanding of what eternal life is. Eternal life is not just about, you know, receiving salvation and going to heaven. Eternal life is knowing the true God. And by that I mean knowing Him, worshiping Him, loving Him, serving Him, obeying Him. Starting now. Okay? Eternal life is not something that you get in the future. It starts now. The moment you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the moment you repent from your sins, you receive eternal life. You become connected to God again. You're not a child of God. Now you know Him. You keep knowing Him. You worship Him. You love Him. You obey Him. You live for Him. That is eternal life. Being connected to God and living in Him and for Him. So let's not just cruise or coast. Let's be very intentional about the way we live our lives. Now you might say to me, "Oh, Pastor Rich, I understand what you're saying, but I'm well past my youth. I'm no longer classified as youth. I'm now old, Pastor Rich. What to do?" Now, it's true that many people have squandered their lives when they were still young. And it's true that a lot of people only remember God when they're old. I still remember one of the observations that our beloved Elder Michael Ang Sr. made when he was still alive. He said, "I've noticed that when a person becomes old, he becomes more spiritual." And that's true. When they were still young, they don't give a toot-toot to live for God, right? Once they become old, oh, they become more spiritual. Why? I still remember there was this guy. He was already in his 40s, maybe late 40s, when I was still a teenager. So this happened more than 20 years ago. And this guy noticed that I was very active in church. I attended worship, I attended prayer meeting, I went out on an outreach, reaching out to street kids. And he said to me, "You know what? I like what you're doing, Richard. I admire you for that." Because at the time I was actually inviting him, "Why don't you join us to our church?" I was still a teenager, he was already in his late 40s. And he said, "Oh, you know what, Richard? I really admire what you're doing. You're going to church. Wow. That's very admirable." But he said to me, "You know what? I still don't have time for that. Anyway, Richard, I promise you, I'll go with you once I already retire." The guy is now in his 70s, and there are no signs that he is going to church. I don't know what he's waiting for. I mean, many people like to say this, "Oh, when I retire, I have more time." Okay, so what are you telling me? Just giving God loose change of your lives? We give God the best years. He deserves it. If we are so good outside in our careers, be better, be excellent in the service of God. Why should the world use up all your talents and your resources, you know, your intelligence? Why should God be always, you know, last in the line of your priorities? "Oh, Pastor Rich, I'm already past my prime. I'm past my youth." Listen to this. If you didn't live for God while you're young, that's regrettable. We cannot take back time. And let me say this to you. No matter how successful you were when you were still young, successful in your career, successful in your field of work, if you did not live for God during those years, during those decades, let me say this up front to you, you were a failure as far as God is concerned. Because God did not create you for your job primarily. God did not create you for that success in career primarily. You know, your job, your career, your interests, all these things are just incidentals to life. These things will only have meaning and eternal significance if you do them for the glory of God. And by that I mean you do them because you want to use them for the glory of God, use them to bring lost souls to Him, use them to minister to other people. If you don't use these things, your business, your career, whatever you have right now, for the glory of God, in the service of God, I tell you, you are a failure. And that's very regrettable that you wasted your life. But listen to this. Yes, you may have wasted your life before when you were still young. Now you're already old. You're no longer a youth. But listen to this. At any rate, you still have a life to live now. Right? Maybe you still have 5 years to live, or 10 years to live, or 15 years, we don't know. At least the fact that you are listening to this sermon, you're still alive. You still have a life to live. Right? And since you have a life to live, I encourage you this time, make the right choice to live for God. Okay? Make the right choice to live for God. Specifically this year, 2017, say to the Lord, "Lord, forgive me. I have not given to you my best years. This is what's left of me. I'm sorry. But Lord, by your grace, I resolve, starting today, I will have you use me to the glory of your name." Amen. We cannot change the past, but we can always make the right choices now. 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 While you are still alive. Brothers and sisters, remember your Creator in the days of your youth. Before you become old, before you become limited in many ways, especially before you die. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much, Lord, for your reminder for all of us through the words of King Solomon. We pray, God, that we will take these things to heart. We'll not allow these things to just fall on deaf ears. Lord, we pray that you will empower us, remind us of what we have heard today, so that every day we will pursue to live for you until the day you call us home, or until the day when you come back for us. Lord, help us to live our lives according to your word. This world has different values. But even if we're the only people left here, you still would want us to live for you against all odds. Because in the end, we are accountable to you. You own us. And you have a purpose for our lives. So help us, Lord. We pray, Lord God, that this sermon will not just be another sermon out there that we have heard, but something that will change our hearts and our lives. For we ask all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.